So the chapter Indigo. The chapter Indigo, written by Louis Fisher, it's not just a complete lesson in itself. This Indigo has been taken from the biography written on Mahatma Gandhi by Louis Fisher. Okay, so it's not a complete chapter in itself. It's an extract from a book written by Louis Fisher on Mahatma Gandhi. So that is Life of Mahatma Gandhi. So Louis Fisher, who was a Jewish American journalist, he was very fond of Mahatma Gandhi, and he wrote his biography on Gandhi. He was so impressed by the methodology, or by the theory, or by the concept, or by what Gandhi, you know, said and did. So the ideology of Gandhi was something which impressed so many people all around the world, and Louis Fisher was one of them. And he decided to write a biography on Gandhi, and this is what we have with us today, Indigo. So Indigo is just one extract, is just a few pages. These are just a few pages from the biography written on Gandhi. And this chapter, you know, in this Indigo, children, you'll come to know about two main things, many things rather, but first of all, this Indigo will give us a clear idea of like what effective leadership is all about. So it's about effective leadership. Just a minute. So what effective leadership is all about? So when we talk about some leader, the one who had an impeccable mark or indelible mark on the people or on the masses, then one name which comes up in our mind, that is Mahatma Gandhi. In order to appreciate Mahatma Gandhi in the real sense, in order to, you know, see what Gandhi did for not only India, but also for the humanity, we need to have a clear insight into what Gandhi was actually. Right? It's very, very important to know like who Gandhi was. It's not just enough to say that Gandhi was the one who played an active role in the Indians, in India's, you know, independence movement. Okay, many children, many people, you know Gandhi only as one of the freedom fighters of independence. Okay, many people know Gandhi as one of the, you know, champions who fought for truth, non-violence, and ahimsa. You know, people, if somebody talk about Gandhi, then people only say these things, like he was a very great freedom fighter. He was a great, he was a champion of, you know, the poor and downtrodden, or the one he was, he lived a simple life, or people say like that he was the one who believed in truth and non-violence. And beyond that, people, you know, they become mum about Gandhi. So that is the reason, like now, many of our youngsters, you know, they have started assessing Mahatma Gandhi as a non-entity. Many children, many youngsters, you know, they talk about Gandhi as a one whom they don't consider to be called as a father of the nation. If he was given the title of the father of the nation, that was a very, you know, that was a very significant title which was given to him, and that was given not for nothing. Okay, it was given for some reason. Okay. So what were the reasons for which Gandhi was given the title as being the father of the nation? Or what was the reason that Gandhi was able to impress not only Indians, but many people all around the world? Okay, so this Louis Fisher is not an Indian. Okay, it's not that only the illiterate or the poor people were his fans. It were many people, even the Britishers, against whom Gandhi waged a war for independence. Even those Britishers were fond of Gandhi. in this chapter we'll come across, we'll read one English person. He will be an English a pacifist, but he was a big fan of Gandhi, and he was extremely impressed by what Gandhi was. So it's very important that we Indians, where the whole world is appreciating Gandhi, the whole world is worshipping Gandhi like anything, is following the ideology of Gandhi, not only as a leader but also as a great human being, then it's very, very important that we Indians know what Gandhi was. Doesn't look nice when an Indian is appreciated by the foreigners, but we Indians forget our own legacy very bad. Okay, there are many other Indians, those who need to be acknowledged and appreciated by we people. But what happens is, like, we come to know from the foreigners that person was really great. Maybe it was Vivekananda, maybe it was Gandhi, or maybe it was Lord Ram, or maybe it was Guru Gobind Singh Ji, or maybe it was Shivaji, or maybe it was Maharana Pratap. So whosoever the great people were with us, or whatever the great legacy we have, it is we people who need to know that, understand that, appreciate that, and if possible, hold on to that. Okay, it's very, very wrong to indulge in undue criticism of somebody, the one who did something actually very great. Okay, so let's see. So let's forget the other aspects, like for what Gandhi is being appreciated. Let's see what Gandhi was. So when you'll read this chapter Indigo, you'll have, number one, a very clear picture of what kind of leader should be there. What makes a person become a great leader? Okay, so here we'll come to know, we'll have a clear insight into the making of a great leader. In the very beginning, let me tell you that Gandhi was not born as a great leader. It's not that when he was getting education, when he was getting academic qualification, that made him a great leader. No, he became a great leader when he met people, when he started knowing the people of his country. So it's the knowledge of your own people which makes you become a leader. It's not your academic qualification. It's not your hunger for power. It's not for money or for anything which makes you a leader. A leader becomes a leader when he becomes one with his people, when he knows what the problems of his people are. Okay? And secondly, leader doesn't become a leader to satisfy his own ego. A person becomes a good leader when he wants to make his public fearless and courageous. So effective leadership. We'll see in Gandhi a perfect leader. And secondly, what we would come to know about this, in this chapter, we would come to know about, we'll come to know, we'll have a true picture of India. We'll have a true picture of India, especially when it was not independent. So why India became, why India became a slave in the hands of Britishers? What were the reasons that Indians became slaves? What were the reasons? The reasons were, which made Indians become slaves were, what made Indians become slaves? Number one, it was because of the fact, like, Indians were not fearless. Then Indians were not united. Indians were not united. Indians were not fearless. And apart from this,
the Indians did not, they were not, you know, well aware of the concepts on cleanliness and all, cleanliness, hygiene and all. So the time when India was, you know, dependent upon Britishers for the governance, the time when Britishers were able to enslave the Indians, it was a time when Indians were not fearless. It was a time when Indians were not united. It was a time when Indians did not have any idea of what the importance of cleanliness and hygiene is. Right? It was a time when people did not have any, you know, facilities of, you know, education or of medicines or what. Then it was that time when when Britishers enslaved Indians. Right? And children, the struggle which India made for independence in 1947, that struggle was done earlier also. That was a time when it was about 1857. You people all know India's struggle for freedom in 1857. And that revolt in 1857 turned out to be a total failure. The reason? Because nobody worked for these factors. Then the effective leadership was missing. Though then we had very, very great freedom fighters like Kampai Tope, Rani Jhansi, Mangal Pandey and all. So many, you know, great warriors, great freedom fighters were there. But yes, one leader was missing, the one who could have made Indians work upon fearlessness, unity and cleanliness. And when Gandhi came in the picture, it was he who realized that unless and until Indians are fearless, they cannot fight against Britishers. So the moment you are fearless, you start off well and half of the victory is achieved. In order to win over anyone or anything, the very first thing required is being fearless. Right? Fearlessness doesn't mean that you start fighting against your own people. Okay, if you start fighting against your own brother fearlessly, that is not a courage. That is being traitor. Okay, try to understand what is to be fearless, what is to be courageous. Standing up and fighting against your own countrymen is not your courage. That means that you are a traitor. So if today we are talking about, like, if Gandhi propagated the factor of fearlessness, it was against the Britishers. It was against the foreign powers. It was not against own Indians, own countrymen. Mind it. Okay, today, because whenever I talk about Gandhi's concept of fearlessness, many students, many people, you know, they confuse the idea of fearlessness with becoming revolutionary. Okay, if Bhagat Singh was a revolutionary, he revolutionized against the foreigners. He wanted the Britishers to leave India because he wanted his own motherland to become free from the shackles of slavery. But today, if we are becoming revolutionary like Bhagat Singh, are we going to fight against the foreign powers or terrorism, or are we fighting against our own country? There is a difference. Okay, don't try to be Bhagat Singh. Okay, don't insult Bhagat Singh's courage, fearlessness. Don't, you know, insult his patriotism by fighting against your own country, by fighting against your own culture. Remember, it's very, very important. Please don't confuse the idea of fearlessness with the idea of being a traitor. Okay? If an army personnel, if a soldier is trained to fight well, then he is not trained to fight against one's own country.
is not trained to fight against one's own country's safety. He is not trained to fight against a country's resources. So when you are fearless, make sure that you are fearless to make your country strong. You are not fearless to make your country become poor and weak. This is what which had been happening in the past. Whatever your demand is, if you have some issue with some authority, that issue is to be sorted out in a very disciplined manner. Okay, because if the authority is doing something, it is doing it because it has the authority. And why it has the authority? Because you people gave him the authority. Government is for the people, by the people, for the people. So don't forget, it is by the people. Okay, by the people means like it is the people, it is the democratic system where the people are in favor of that authority. So if two people are against that authority, doesn't mean that 98 people don't matter, right? So don't insert Shahid Bhagat Singh, okay, Kartar Singh Sarabha kinds of peoples, sacrifice by doing something which is illegal. Okay, here Mahatma Gandhi will also give a very, very effective and justified definition of what is being legal, illegal, or what is being, he also went in for disobedience movement. So what is it to be disobedient? So there is a difference. It's not that you disobey the law for your personal benefits. Okay, you cannot disobey the law for your personal ego. When you disobey the law for your own country's good, the way our soldiers do, the way our freedom fighters did. Maybe it was Mahatma Gandhi or maybe it was Bhagat Singh. Okay, so both, maybe Mahatma Gandhi or maybe Bhagat Singh, we cannot compare them. Both of them stand at a place where they are unreachable, both of them. But it would be wrong to say that somebody did more and the other did less. That would be wrong, because both of them had their own strategies. One was a hot-blooded, warm-blooded youngster, and the other was a very mature-blooded person. Okay, he had logic behind him and his actions. He had the reason behind his actions. So when we will be doing it, so what made Indians the slaves to the Britishers? They were not fearless, they were not united, and they were the ones, those who were illiterate and had no idea of what importance or significance is of cleanliness or maybe of hygiene. And children, when you will realize, so it were the times when we were not fearless, when we were not united, or when we did not bother for cleanliness. So then we were slaves to the Britishers. Okay? So don't you think that the same time is now? Now also we are not united. We don't mind fighting against our country at the name of our own religion. Are we united now? Don't we sometimes fight over petty issues related to religion or sect or creed or caste? If it is, are we now free? Are we actually living an independent life? Are we enjoying independence, which was given to us by those freedom fighters with their sacrifice? Have we maintained that cleanliness which Gandhi, struggled in that times? If you talked about cleanliness before 1947, have we been able to achieve that target of cleanliness by 2021? No. We might be bothering to keep our houses clean, but we hardly bother to keep the road clean, right? We might clean up the whole mess from our house and we don't mind throwing it out. Maybe in the empty plots or maybe on the roads,
while enjoying the ride in the car, we don't mind throwing wrappers all out from the car. Because we feel like our car is clean, our house is clean, that's it. So we are the same what those people were in the times when India had not become independent. So children, we'll pick up the concept tomorrow. The time is almost over. So keep your books with you tomorrow and don't be absent, be regular, okay? Okay, thank you.